and thank you to the organization of the CAI to give us the chance to come here, especially when it's a project that happened in Spain and has no the only link with UK is that I work here. Work we're gonna present us is between Rafael and me. Rafael had a problem 2 years ago. He needed to survey a huge amount of very big areas in a quick, non-invasive and cheap way. So first he will tell you about the problem he had, after I will tell you the solution I think I gave him, and finally he will give the feedback of the happy customer. So here I leave you with Rafael.
Approaching the problem, located in the route of the Roman road in Álava, which corresponded to 30 formations in the Antonine itinerary, has been an historical and archaeological conundrum for the past 200 years. Since the first conjecture was made at the end of the 18th century, there have been numerous suggestions for this course. This proposal suffered from two main problems. Firstly, the failure to identify the mansion referred to it to in the Antonine itinerary. And secondly, the lack of a comprehensive study method for his search and identification. The first problem was solved at the beginning of the 21st century. The location of these mansions have now been pinpointed with archaeological data, and that goes beyond mere hypotheses. This allows us to theorize about the likely corridors through which the Iter 34 could have run. Our goal was to tackle the second problem with the study we carried out in 2017. The multifaceted study included reviewing the historical and archaeological source, both ancient and modern. 18th and 19th century maps and plans we describe the road were verified. We conducted an exhaustive toponic study of both current ancient place names mentioned in the medieval written sources, especially those dating from the 9th to the 12th century. We examined sets of vertical aerial photographs dating from 1932 to the present, as well as the more recent low-level photographs. Where possible, we analyzed the area with LiDAR, and we carried out fieldworking and opened archaeological test pits. A possible solution: precision agriculture and NDVI. In addition, we experimented with a novel methodology for the detection of archaeological remains taken from the techniques of precision agriculture. The Iter 34 measures 65 kilometers, so given the size of the project, it was necessary to use a system that allowed coverage of the full length of the road to be made quickly. This also has to be non-invasive and still provide reliable results in the detection of a warrior linear structure. Our available economic resources allow for 10 areas to be surveyed using drones equipped with infrared cameras that will allow the application of the NDVI. These 10 zones cover significant parts of the road where the presence of the Iter 34 was determined to be either secure, probable, or undocumented. The inclusion of the securely identified routes was necessary in order to confirm that the results obtained were reliable. There were, so to speak, control samples. This occurred in two places where the road has been identified archaeologically, through field working and in test pits, areas 4 and 5. In the zones where the road was considered probable, there were 5 cases in which the historiography suggests the location of Iter 34 ran through those areas of memory. However, there was no reliable evidence for the road in these areas, zones 1, 2, 3, 9, and 10. With regards to the undocumented places, we found 3 areas in which precise course of the road has never been defined in the historiography, areas 6, 7, and 8. We therefore expected, first of all, to determine the validity of method to recognize various remains, and secondly, we were looking for a solution for the sections in which traditional research tools have not been used or were not working well.
Thank you. Well, some years ago I started experimenting with the cameras prefer to capture near infrared wavelengths and also NDVI. From the very beginning, it was very obvious that the infrared part of the spectrum is much more useful for identifying archaeological buried remains than the visible part of the spectrum. That I was start thinking, well, maybe perhaps we can see crop marks more clearly than in visible light. Maybe we can even see crop marks that you will not be able to see at that time of the year or in that place. Maybe we can even perform an archaeological survey just based on those invisible crop marks. The basis of these all those methods is that the plants, when they are performing the photosynthesis, they actively reflect huge amounts of infrared energy. This is one of the most dramatic jumps in energy about the reflection onto mankind. You can see on the left part the reflectance of the plants on the infrared part between the healthy and the vegetation and the stress of the vegetation. The difference is huge compared with the same bands in the visible spectrum. So we should be able to see at least more clearly any kind of problems. We expect that that in an infrared photograph, as the parts of the plant that are performing photosynthesis, not the trunk or the stalks or the leaves, reflect huge amounts of energy, they are always gonna look like white. The whiter the plant, the healthier it is. This is one of the basis of the modern precision agriculture techniques. One of the index that is more widely used is the NDVI. The NDVI index takes the infrared part of the spectrum and normalize it somehow with the visible part of the spectrum. So the most classic formula is near infrared less visible divided by near infrared plus visible. Usually you give it funny colors going from blue to red. In one photograph here we can see that all the things that are dead or are not making any kind of photosynthesis look like blue, while the plants that are alive go from yellow, green to red. The other one has a different color scheme from brown to green. In this study I have made everything in black and white because I find it easier, at least for me, I can see things better in black and white than with those funny color schemes. So I will try to keep it the closest way we will see in infrared, near infrared photographs. So the black are the areas that are not giving any radiation, and the white are the areas that are reflecting more infrared. So the whiter you see in the photographs, the healthier the plants are. For this study we have used, well, we take photographs from drones, we made different experiments at flying at 25, 75, 120 meters with visible cameras, infrared, long pass filters from 620, a lot of different combinations. The one that worked better for us finally was fly about 75 meters high. With what is called a pseudo NDVI, it's not the real NDVI you made in a single photograph. You take in one band the near infrared, and in another band you take something similar to the visible, but you can make the index with only one photograph, which makes everything easier. So we fly at 75 meters, what gave us a spatial resolution of 3.2 centimeters per pixel after we processed the photographs in ground deploy, getting some orthomosaics that we imported in QGIS to calculate the NDVI, take measurements and everything, and after we compare those orthomosaics with the historic images from the server, looking for what those features may be. So in theory, we are expecting that cut features, and we are trying to see crop marks. And so we expect that cut features will appear like lighter, and walls or other things that don't let the plants grow so well will appear as darker. That is the theory, but we were not sure if this will really work. In one of the first flights we made, we saw this white line going in diagonal there. So we assume it should be a cut feature. And luckily we found a photograph in the moment where that trench was open when they were building the gas pipes. They took the photograph just in the moment the trench is open, so there is no doubt that this white line is produced by that trench. In the other hand, we have a dark line here that we didn't, is very narrow and well defined, so we assume it should be more or less recent. So we try to find it in historic photographs, and we find the wall that create that line. So now we can assume that really the theory works, and we are going to have whiter colors for cut features, and darker for walls or pavements or so on. Then we should assume that a Roman road should look like a darker area caused by the pavement, surrounded by two narrower white lines that are produced by the roadside ditches. And that's exactly what we found in nearly all the areas, in 8 of the 10 areas. You can see, well, I hope you can see, I don't know how clearly it is in the photograph. In the center, you have a darker area that is the pavement, and on the sides, the roadside ditches. What happens is the roadside ditches go slowly eating the pavement. The pavement of the road goes falling into the roadside ditches, so they become bigger and the pavement is smaller. But it's a very consistent road, and we tested in 10 places, and we found it in 8, and it's always about 7-8 meters wide, and the pavement about 5-6. So it's we have reasons to think that it's the same road, the one we found in all the areas. I guess you're not going to be able to see the key from there, so I'm going to first tell you the purple line is the conjecture path of the Roman road that Rafael want me to check. The little white arrows mark positive anomalies, so areas where the plants are doing better, and the little black arrows mark negative anomalies. The first area we couldn't do anything. We went there and it was just plowed. There were no vegetation to make any kind of NDVI analysis, so it was a total failure. In the second one, we found traces of the Roman road coming here, disappearing this area, and after. And after it appears at the end, where we could see perfectly the roadside ditches. In the top right corner, at the end, you can see that it's quite well preserved there, the road. Next area is a very interesting one. We have the road in the middle, but we have a lot of little channels, wells, silos, other features. In the right corner, we have some buildings here. Here we can see that it's so much clearer in infrared photography than in the visual one. The one at the right is the same photograph taken in the same flight at the same moment, and we can barely see anything. This is the landscape we can see from this photograph. It's amazing that you go there and using techniques to manage the landscape nowadays. In half an hour, you have a peek into what was the landscape in Roman times. You can see the walls, the channels, the wells. Here we can see the road. Here we can see the road and also a post-medieval road crossing and some features caused by water. That's also an interesting one. We have a lot of features appearing here. This one is especially interesting in the top. The darker area probably is the crumble of a building, and we are seeing the walls of the building in negative. Really what we are seeing here is the rubber trenches of the walls that have been taken out. All the features we have here, they seem to have two different alineations, ones that go very well with the Roman road in red, probably from Roman times, and others in yellow that correspond to another moment. Here we can see the road again. In this one we can see a lot of, we can see again fossilized and agricultural landscape, but not from Roman times. This is just before the field enclosure. As we can see in the historic photograph below, it perfectly matches one thing with the other. Luckily, there were some works in that area, and Rafael was going there, and in a part that we consider to be the Roman road, suddenly, yeah, there was a hole, and you can see the Roman road, you can see the ditch and the pavement. Conclusions. Well, I think it's clear that it's much better the infrared or the NDVI photography to show archaeological features than visible light. Here we can compare those areas, you can barely see anything in visible light. And the number of features we have recovered in infrared is enormous compared with other techniques, like the historic photographs, only 40, and NDVI 150. Compared with visible light, again, it's nearly three times the amount of features. A big work like the Roman road, you can see it in almost any technique, but all those little channels and walls and things, it proves to be so much better than NDVI techniques.
The result. We do not hesitate to rate the use of this method has highly satisfactory, and we achieve our main objectives. The validity of the method has been demonstrated as far as the exploration of archaeological remains is concerned, and we succeed in vastly increasing the identified sections of the burial road. In the zones used as control for the experiment, where we knew the cause of the road, the anomalies detected by the NDVI correspond fully with the observation made for other methods. These zones correspond to the surrounding mansiones, Anquivitates of Velella and Suestatio. Out of the five surveyor zones considered as probable localizations of the road, four obtained results compatible with the course of the Iter 54, and one obtained a negative result. In the undocumented sites, positive results were recorded in two of the three zones, and negative results in one of them. The two negative results obtained are due to two different reasons. In the first case, the absence of crop did not provide NDVI information, so the result was as expected. As for the second, this was simply because there were no archaeological remains. From the methodological point of view, it is a success because no remains were recorded in a place where it is very unlikely that there will be. In this way, we have additionally tested the experiment against false positives. Regarding the positive result, it is clear that the results were better than expected. If our aim was to determine whether it is possible to identify the cause of a Roman road with this method and improve our knowledge about it, then we have achieved far more than our initial course. In two cases, in addition to the course of the rock, anomalies were observed in the crops that are compatible with wheel structure. Today, these have not been observed with other techniques. In zone 3, wilding remains were seen which can be identified as a structure associated with the urban or suburban area of the Mansio and Kivitas of Velilla. In the case of the zone 6, the possible structural remains found will fit with the structure associated with the deserted medieval settlement of Garona, documented in 1025 AD and which disappeared during the 13th century. Final conclusions. We believe we have shown that the gambling of this method has helped us solve a very complex problem in the heritage of Álava. Furthermore, we can see that these tools offer very high potential for both extensive and intensive archaeological research that obtain significant results in a fast, efficient, and only possible.